pleasure to present some of the lessons that we've learned over the last 2 years on the undiagnosed disease program. It's also my honor to welcome you home. Cape Town is now my new home. And one of the first things I did when I came home was to establish this undiagnosed disease program, and I hope that you'll see why it was necessary and why it continues to be necessary. That's my favorite picture of the diagnostic policy. Places how we get their shoes. He's embarking on a journey. You can see how some of those trails are meandering, some go around and round in circles, often leading nowhere. If you can think of those trees, investigations that are punctuating his journey, some of those investigations are invasive. Many of them will never even lead to a diagnosis, and he keeps going round and round in circles and never gets a diagnosis. If you are lucky enough to be born and raised at Children's Hospital in California, you get to your diagnosis in 13 and a half hours. If you are not so lucky to be born in Africa like we are, you can live on your diagnostic policy and have a great question mark over your head for the rest of your life. We need to change that. As you can see, we work in a very diverse clinical situation. Means that we are really skilled at dysmorphology across ethnicities and cultures. But dysmorphology only gets you so far. Apart from the little baby with albinism in the top row, who I typically diagnose and know his genetic underlying variant, because it's the commonest variant for ocular pretense albinism, the rest of them are still in need of a definitive genomic diagnosis. We know that rare diseases are rare individually, but collectively they affect a considerable number of people across the world. We're talking about 300 million. Almost 4 million of those live in South Africa. You can think of how many millions more live in the rest of Africa. And the problem is that most of them are still undiagnosed. When we think about the numbers of children that are affected, the numbers of children that don't live to see their birthdays, the number of neonatal ICU deaths that are caused by rare diseases, we can't be seriously thinking about doing anything against our infant mortality rates or our high mortality rates, or seriously thinking about the UN sustainability development goals without thinking about rare diseases and without prioritizing rare diseases. And the diagnosis is the first step in that direction. So we want to go from being undiagnosed to doing something about that to getting to a diagnosis. I'm very encouraged by the fact that 72% of rare diseases are genetic origin, that means we can and should and will find the answer. We need to start this undiagnosed disease program on a shoestring budget. I phoned a friend, I phoned a few friends, I got collaborations that in the first year were able to set up access to NOC6000 and get access to exome sequencing. I established my research group, trained them to be able to analyze the data, and we could get going with moving from undiagnosed to diagnosed. Quick background about where we started. Our patients, the majority of them, obviously undiagnosed, majority had no previous testing, that's different to other undiagnosed disease programs across the world. We almost have no access to trios, so the father is often missing. Our population is majority non-consanguineous, and I didn't concentrate on any particular diagnosis or any particular presentation. Anybody who was undiagnosed and looking for a diagnosis was welcome and eligible to be included in the UDP. As far as the team, it started with 2 people. We are now 10 and growing. We did have no skills, especially finding informatics at the beginning. That has also changed, thank goodness. Funding was a problem at the beginning. Like I said, we started on a shoestring budget because most of the time the genomics is not a priority for Africa. And the infrastructure for the first year, we had to outsource our testing, but we have been steadily building systems in-house for capacity and to be able to do things in Africa by ourselves. And so I present just a few snippets from our first 100 diagnosed, or first 100 patients included in the UDP, and you can see that they range in age from stillborn babies up until 35 years of age. I think that man was rather an outlier because I really concentrated on children in the first couple of years to make the diagnosis as early as possible to have the biggest impact. And grandparents, CMEs, which were confirmed, and a mixture of inheritance patterns, including autosomal dominant, including interestingly enough, homozygous autosomal recessive. And like I said, the majority have not undergone any previous testing and only got their diagnosis through this one. We were also able to identify 25 novel genes and 22 genes. That's expected, I think, in an understudied population like ours. And so a few lessons from the UTP. The first one is the power of translational research. Right at the beginning, we identified a common variant that underlies Leber syndrome in our population. We were able to very quickly, thank you to the UCT in the Chalice team, for setting up local testing for this variant. We can do prenatal testing, it's now available, and the baby on the left is now a toddler, and his mother underwent prenatal testing during the latest pregnancy. They continue to look at the pregnancy, and his little brother, who is affected, is now born. We can add to the phenotype across the lifespan, and now even include what is Leber syndrome, pediatric Leber syndrome, look like in fetal life. And of course, this has helped us to increase our access, patient access to resources, and we're building a community, because they spend most of their time outside of the hospital, and it's important for them to have access to other affected people that speak their own language, that have a similar background. These are some of the first, or one of some of the first diagnoses, very rare disorders, but I bet that they're definitely not the only. So I know somebody told me that there's a baby with an mTOR variant in the DD Africa study. Felicia with TRAC mutation is the 26th person in the world diagnosed with her diagnosis. The boy with NOMO is the 13th, and just recently published him. And I encourage you to go and see the posters of some of our students to see what they've been up to, what first in Africa looks like, and maybe you have a patient that looks similar or has a similar diagnosis and you can connect them. So those secondary and incidental findings that everybody talks about, we had an opt-in option for secondary findings, and only 4 out of the 100 families agreed to get more information, not related necessarily to the actual problem that their children are facing. And we diagnosed one family with a BRCA1 pathogenic variant that has led us to be able to do cascade testing. And some of the families have not presented for testing, those who have and undergone testing, those who are positive are now enrolled in the surveillance. And so that's had a very huge impact on that one family. It's very different to Europe, where we probably have the exact opposite, maybe 96% of them would have opted to get secondary findings. That's something that one of my students is working on to figure out why this is different in South Africa. For incidental findings, this one patient who I was convinced had osteogenesis imperfecta, she was short, she had loose clearing, she had early fractures, joint hyperplasia and instability. Very quick and easy, Kimberly, one of our students, identified the COL1A1 pathogenic variant, and I thought, well, her story is over, she's diagnosed, brilliant. But because we use initially the own directed way of variant prioritization and identification, PTPN11 also came up as a pathogenic variant. That's a very well-known mutation causing Noonan syndrome. And I called her back to clinic and thought, that was Noonan. It's a very common condition, I shouldn't be missing that. And on further inspection, she did have myelitosis, but that was all that she had. We enrolled her in the normal Noonan surveillance. Heart was normal, abdomen ultrasound was normal. She had mild disability, but was still complicated. And so these incidental findings are things that we don't necessarily know how to look for, but are sometimes there and often a big surprise. So I'd like to follow up on Lula's variant interpretation thread, that we should be very careful in South Africa and in Africa with variant interpretation. Three little girls with three different, what I call the distinct conditions, complicated by multiple gender abnormalities, all had this cancer one splice site variant. going to ACG inside the epigenetic. It's absent from all the other cases, it's not uncommon. And some of the patients were such quick fix, and so they said, lactic epigenetic, they have put into this syndrome. And I said, clinically, never. I found in my house that these children do not have put into this syndrome. And so we went, because clinically I didn't believe it was put into this syndrome, clinically I thought they had three different conditions. We tested the parents that were available and we found out that it was inherited from one unaffected parent. In each case, it was not available. And in our data bank of about 300 H-chromosome genome sequences, we identified four other participants in the data set, including healthy parents who also carry this variant. And so it's one positive of disease in our population, and definitely not positive of disease syndrome in these patients. So I stress the need for locally relevant and representative databases that we can use to help us to proper clinical interpretation in our context. And you can see in the bar there are two entries. One is likely benign, the other is likely pathogenic. So we do need solutions which allow us to shape across the data across institutions taking into account our local regulations. I do say that Africa is the next frontier because I believe that we have the ability to do a lot more here and figure out a lot more. And maybe because our patients are so interested in data sharing and because we have a lot less baggage of historical data sharing problems, that this is probably the place where we can try out things that might work, not only for us, but for the rest of the world. And you've seen this picture from Alexei's presentation earlier. I just say that I think this is the next frontier, but this is really the next frontier, that the map has nothing to do with genetics, it's a representation of GDP. But you can see that I think that we should be doing more in Africa on Africans, because that's very representative of just how much GWAS is done on African people, just how much diagnosis is available on the continent, and that really needs to change, and I'm calling for more access, more equity, and more representation. So where to from here, what about all those still undiagnosed? I think that there are many, many, many novel genes still to be discovered in our population. We are very privileged that the UDP lives on Africa's largest genome campus, on type of the hospital campus. We've got a brand new research institute. We've got brand new Nova seats with the help of some champions and supporters. We are hoping that very soon we can use the infrastructure and the skills that we've built up over the last few years to serve the hub and as a, to benefit not only the rest of South Africa, but the rest of the region. And so, let me see if this works. I have to thank all the families that have taken part. Up until now, we have over 700 families that have been recruited and are anxiously waiting for results that are going to change their lives. Thanks to my research group, to the clinical team in the hospital, all our collaborators. The funders who finally did come to the party, so we're hoping that genomics really is the priority for Africa. And I'm hiring, so if anybody wants to put postdocs and PhD students, please send them my way. Thank you.
Environment where, you know, depending on where you live, you might have access to
very much, and to every